A very good evening to all of you. I have selected a simple topic of great importance for surgeons, and that is a post-operative fever. This is, of course, thanks to our Manipal Academy of Higher Education leadership from 1953, and today it is like this. And so most of my whatever patients whom I am showing you or some temperature charts belong to our institution, including our hospital. So these are some of the contents which I'll be speaking. Like any other talk, you have introduction, pathogenesis, etc., etc. So at the end of the class, you should be able to take home this, some of these important messages. So with this, we'll start the introductory part. We have seen now very many times, once a post-operative patient gets fever, means, you know, it disturbs the surgeon. Obviously, what is happening inside? That is what our worry. So it's important that we realize the differences between a normal physiological response to surgery and what is pathological. And when it comes to pathology, it should be infectious and non-infectious. So we need to have some kind of a systematic approach so that we understand it better, so that we don't ask for too many investigations which are actually costly. And it also, whatever we do, should improve the patient's outcome. So with this now, you know, this is what is normal body temperature, centigrade as well as Fahrenheit written there. There can be a variation of, you know, half a degree is allowed. And the main center of our temperature regulation is in hypothalamus. That we should know. And this we'll be talking little one or two slides extra. Right. So then what is fever? So obviously a documented temperature more than, if you take in the morning, it's 37.2 degrees centigrade. And at night, it is 37.7. I mentioned to you, half degree is accepted. Right. So, when we talk about post-operative fever, see, temperature is different, and this is now post-operative fever. It should be more than 38 degrees on two consecutive post-operative days, or more than 39 degrees centigrade or 102.2 Fahrenheit on any first post-operative itself. So, this is a post-operative fever. Look at the incidence. It's quite a significant incidence, 13% to 14%. But interestingly, we have seen every surgeon knows about post-operative fever. You would have definitely managed, self-limiting sometimes, but observation. There is a small subset, but remember, that can be a little bit dangerous. You require more, you know, investigation. And also remember, any spike of fever following a surgery within a month duration, this is a common phenomenon. Even we call as a, even in a, what do you mean by post-operative mortality? It doesn't mean it should occur immediately in this post-operative period, etc. No. Within a 1 month of the post-operative period, fever is also called as post-operative fever. You may do some hernia or whatever surgery, goes home, comes back after 5 days or 10 days or 15 days, it's still called as a post-operative fever. So what exactly happens in this? Basically, it is the prostaglandins, PGE2. That is what is usually released, elevated in a hypothalamic tissue. That is what happens. And that is near the third cerebral ventricle. Because concentration of the prostaglandin E2 are highest there. And in fact, it's called as organum vasculosum lamina terminalis. I just given this for some of them who are going for, you know, entrance examination, may help them. That's the reason. Is lot of capillaries are there, very vascular one. And interestingly, you destroy that, you know, that reduces the ability of a pyrogens to produce fever. So this is what is the picture. We might have read about this, we might have forgotten, but I'm also not very much familiar. But just to give some idea about this, this is the area. That's the posterior pituitary secreting hormones there, and that is the area of organum vasculosum, right? So this picture will give you some idea about, you know, where is pineal body, you can see here, and where is that subfornicular organ. So these are some of the important point, what has been called as circumventricular organs. So this is what is important to know. Whenever you have a fever, the organ which is involved, right? Now, what is fever then? Why it is produced? The substance is what is called as pyrogen. Now, what is pyrogen? Is the which are exogenous, can be outside. What are those? Firstly, we talk about microbial toxins. All of you know, famous gram-negative shock means a lot of lipopolysaccharide, they are endotoxins. Or can be a enterotoxins from staph, or even group A and group E streptococcal toxins. They are actually called as super antigens. In fact, they are quite dangerous sometimes. It can also produce streptococcal shock syndromes also. So now among the pyrogens now, what are these endogenous pyrogens? So if a question is asked, why do you get fever? What exactly is the problem? It's basically a cytokines. You know, cytokines are the one, now everyone talks about the cytokine storm. No? So now you see this. These are basically interleukin 1s, interleukin 6, tumor necrosis factor, interferon alpha, and a ciliary neurotrophic factor. So whenever there is some kind of a pyrogen, whether it's a bacteremia, septicemia, endotoxin, exotoxin, etc., some of these are acting now, and they produce increased prostaglandin E2 levels, where in the hypothalamus, and it raises the so-called the set point to a core temperature. So this is what happens in major diseases, right? So whatever I have spoken to you in a simple language here, toxins, activation of these macrophages, endothelial cells, etc., cytokines are released. Same thing I have already talked to you. See, they attack the hypothalamus here. Prostaglandin is released and thermoregulatory set point is raised. Body try to conserve the heat and heat production. The net result is the development of fever. So this is basically a pathogenesis of the fever. Now, as a surgeon, especially laparotomies, a lot of gram-negative patients, gram-negative shock patients we operate, gangrenes, pus inside, a little bit definition of a sepsis everybody should know, because there is a small change in the definition. That's what is the sepsis now. This is not a complicated chart at all. If you concentrate for a few minutes, this is the newer definition of the sepsis for your information. It's from the third international consensus definition. And quickly concentrate here first. First, when patient operated, and let us say he has got suspected infection, whatever, you first ask for what has been called as a Q SOFA. Q is actually quick. SOFA means we'll tell you. And that's the scoring is given to that. We'll talk about that. That is two there, two. And sepsis still suspected, but score is less than two means you monitor. But score is more than two means now you go for a actually SOFA scoring. That is nothing but sequential organ failure, right? So whatever I have written here, just look this. So whenever you are suspected infection, what is that you are going to do? Q SOFA. What is Q refers to? Quick assessment. So what is that quick assessment? Now it's only three organs here. Three organs. What are three? See here. One is the cranial cavity here, cranium, cerebrum. Another is chest. Another is cardia. Three C's. Remember 3C for a quick score. It is mainly here GCS, everyone knows. And tachypnea, 22 is the respiratory rate here mentioned. Hypertension of systolic blood to 100. Very easy. Anybody can calculate this bedside. If your patient has got 0 or 1 point, means post-operatively, it's not a high risk at all. A postgraduate can easily do this. if patient has got more than 2 or 3, high risk. That means you have done a quick SOFA scoring. Imagine your patient has got 3 points or more. Then what do you do? That's what I have written here. See the original chart, remember? You have done quick SOFA score. Less than 2, don't worry, manage here. But now 2 or more, that means there is some problem with the organ dysfunction. Now then you have to put what is called an actual SOFA scoring. That is nothing but, these are all available in all charts. You just have to keep it in front of you. Sequential organ failure assessment, right? Now look at that CVS we have done. RS you have done already. CNS you have done 3C. This I put it as chest. Easy to remember. Now what are the other three you have to do, which are common, because we have to see liver for that bilirubin, kidney, creatinine, and of course blood, very important here, sepsis. Platelets, they are all 10 to the power of 3 of cubic cells per cubic millimeter. So that's how you calculate various scoring systems. So this is what is called as a SOFA scoring system. So just for the benefit of every one of you, this, please by heart this chart, very important chart of the newer definition of sepsis. The old definition is not there now, where you calculate that much respiratory, this one temperature 101, 102, not there now for to assess the scoring system. So Q refers to quick, in which there are only 3, chest, cardiac, and of course cranial cavity here. And here comes the SOFA scoring proper, CVS, RS, CNS, and of course bilirubin, creatinine, platelet. I hope I have made the things clear to you. That means patient has got sepsis. Now look at this chart now. This SOFA score, less than 9, see the mortality, and more than 11 means what is the mortality. One more very important thing. So that means our patient is here now, sepsis. Once your patient has got sepsis, whether he has got 9 or 10 or 11 score, now you have to look out this. If the blood pressure vasopressors are required to maintain the mean arterial pressure, or serum lactate is more, means they are in septic shock. I am not going to talk about you more details about sepsis and septic shock. It is a different issue. But remember, whenever you have got a post-operative, you have done intestinal anastomosis, etc., patient is not doing well, you put a simple start with a quick SOFA score. After that, just add 3 important things there, bilirubin, creatinine, platelets, and you get a score, and easy to calculate, and then think of a septic shock, and of course treat accordingly. So with this background now, we'll go on to some of the important cause of etiology, the post-operative fever. I mentioned to you in the initial part, it is classically divided as a infectious and non-infectious. Whether you do a sputum culture or a pus gram stain positive or any culture, means there is a definite infection. But we also should know what is called as non-infectious disease. There may not be any organisms, neither in the blood nor in any stains. So you call them as non-infectious. When it comes to infection, just remember some of the important things here. These are easy to remember as a CRUSS. C-R-U-S-S. You know the most of our surgical patients may have a catheters, whether it's a urinary or a respiratory or a central line or surgical site infections. So it's a quick reference for you. Whenever you have an infectious etiology you suspect, this is what you should be a checklist now. Or it could be a part of the systemic sepsis, all the organs. Somebody would have done a spinal or epidural or a complication, see that epidural abscess, or a myocarditis patient, or could be a necrotizing fasciitis, cellulitis, pressure sore. So various way you can, easy for remembrance. So remember as a CRUSS, but don't forget the simple things first, but then go for systemic problems. Each organ you may have to take into account. But equally, non-infectious things, there are many here, see. The typical, we say, no, head to toe examination to be done. When your patient has got fever, we'll come to that. So these are all various causes, starting from simple deep vein thrombosis to all this can produce inflammation and produce pyrexia or a fever. They need not have any infectious etiology, but you just need to have a vigilant post-operative period. You have seen many times patients have got hypertension ICU and there's evidence of acalculus cholecystitis. There's no infection there. It's acalculus because of hypertension. All of you know about the halothane-induced once of hepatic necrosis, acute pancreatitis. Even for that matter, thyroid storm we get in the post-operative period, uncontrolled, thyrotoxicosis. You get a very hyperpyrexia, adrenal insufficiency. They all can produce what has been called a systemic inflammatory response syndrome and even a fever, but there is no infection involved, including a trauma. So we need to be aware of this condition before you start really going. Now, if you look at the drugs, there are so many drugs, but we also need to have some idea about a list which I have given you, because very often you come across this problem in the post-operative period. They are on antipsychiatric drugs. They may be taking rifampicin. So many drugs, will come to that. Patient is alcohol withdrawal. That also can give rise to fat embolism. So a vigilant post-operative period, we need to keep it in mind, because otherwise you may miss a chance to treat this. A retained foreign body, whether it's a mesh or, can't call the mesh as a foreign body. I was about to talk about sponges. So initially you will have a low-grade temperature unless it gets infected later. So it's important to realize these are the various causes, right? So again, I will not go into the details about the various drugs starting from, but we'll come to that later, common drugs like cephalosporins, etc. Halothane, of course, no longer being used nowadays. So I think that problem is not there. So drug fever, I was talking to you, it's about 2%. But also remember, don't over-diagnose anything for that matter. It's good that you first rule out what is the cause of fever in my case, and then start asking the question whether these are out of its cephalosporins, phenytoin sodium, indomethacin. These are some of the few drugs which can cause fever. And how do you know it's a drug induced? Just stop that drug, the fever will stop. This is what is drug induced fever. Now comes the important thing in the post-operative period. We'll be talking more details soon. But to this one list, within hours, what is this trauma? Surgical incision itself is a trauma. So no wonder you get early fever. It can be due to surgery itself. You would have treated the patient with the transfusion, some or whatever, you might have developed a thrombosis, etc. Now, what do you mean by acute? Acute means within first week. The definition of in the fever, when you talk about acute, means 1 week. This is the time patient in the hospital. Patient has got a major abdominal surgery. So this is the time to think about all these things, including pneumonia, UTI, etc. Again, you need to have a checklist here. What kind of a patient you are treated, and subacute or something which happens usually 1 to 4 days later. Again, ICU, nosocomial infections, abscesses, Clostridium difficile infection. All this can give rise to. All this can give rise to fever in the post-operative period. So now intraoperative fever and immediate post-operative. Prior infection sometime would have missed, or a patient has come with appendicular small perforation would have treated, that can continue. So don't get panic, post-appendicectomy fever, because he already had that. Blood transfusion and one malignant hyperthermia, I'll be speaking a little later. Most important thing, as I mentioned to you, there are so many causes we have given you for the post-operative fever, but take it at least mind. wind, water, walking wound, wonder drugs, what did we do? You get commonly these five in all the books. What did we do is, I have added this, and worry is also I have added. We'll come to that. What is that? Wind is nothing but respiratory infection. These are the IV lines, deep pain, thrombosis, wound. Open the wound and see after 48 hours or maybe 72 hours. Drugs, I mentioned to you, some drugs can cause fever. What did we do? I always tell the residents that in the post-operative period when there's a fever, everybody say tries to put the blame on the chest. So there is some respiratory infection. There is some urinary infection. There is something. But most importantly, we forget to answer this question. What did I do? Is it an ulcer perforation I have closed? Whether it has given way or anastomosis has leaked or whether the loop has become gangrenous. You have done a colostomy. I missed a patient who is having a continuous fever because every time I ask, no sir, everything is okay. Chest is normal. I have done ultrasound normal. Everything normal. Whenever I come to the rounds, I forgot to watch one because they say, sir, we have done a colostomy dressing. The ends of the colostomy were slowly becoming gangrenous. So it was an APR in a 75-year-old person. So what I'm trying to tell is, you have to be extremely cautious and careful at this stage that what did we do? And of course, worry is nothing but today, anxiety, worry, depression, also have been blamed for increased levels of prostaglandins activity and produced fever. So this is the 6 or 7 worries or W's you can take home. So now that's the same thing. Whatever I have got, this is from the literature. I mentioned about five things. And this timing also tells you something that wound, walking and wonder drugs, see, they can go even up to 3 to 7 days, right? You know, wound infection, initially wound infection, slowly you find intestinal loop there, maybe a burst abdomen or a anastomotic leak, etc. So it's important to realize when you get the fever. So this, the same thing, whatever I have shown you just now in the form of chart, just look here first day, diagnosis is not very clear whenever there's a fever. But it, as you come down here, 5th day, 6th day, 7th day, you get some kind of a, you know, diagnosis. Look at the wound infection. You can get all the 7 days, even after also you get a wound infection here. And look at the respiratory here, chest infections, pneumonia. So this is just a simple, chart to understand when you can get the fever. So I hope it's clear now. At least important things to realize. Keep it in mind. Wind, water, walking wound, wonder drug, what did we do? And also anxiety, worry, depression. Right. Now we'll come specific to a few of the situations of first 48 hours. I mentioned to you that surgery itself is a stress. Surgical incision itself is a stress. So you can see there, no? Almost 15 to 40% of the patients can have a fever in the first day. But they are very short-lived. You don't require anything. That's again, cytokine is released because the incision itself, it's called a first day fever. So just see here, first day fever is also due to fear. So every patient who undergoes surgery, there will be some kind of a fear. So keep it in mind. So don't treat unnecessarily a first day fever because we think it is normal. As high as 5 to 10%, I have already mentioned to you. But in a major surgery, it can go as high as 15 to 40%. A common question which is asked, it may not be directly related, but today is the period of cytokine storm of the COVIDs. So these are some of the basic questions they will ask you. What is this cytokine? Is it basically a protein? What is lymphokine? It is nothing but cytokine by lymphocytes. What is monokines? Cytokine produced by monocyte. And what is chemokine? By the chemotactic activity. And what is interleukin? I showed you interleukin 1, interleukin 6. They are all cytokines made by one leukocyte, but they act on the other leukocyte. This is the problem. you know, they fight among themselves. That is the one which can produce ultimately the various reactions. That's what happens due to the cytokine activity. And it's written that autocrine means they act on their own and cause problems. Like you get in pancreas, you know, autodigestion. Pancreatic enzymes, they, you know, digest pancreas itself. Something like cytokines are acting on the cells itself, where they have come from. That's called as autocrine. Or a neighboring, that's paracrine. Or a distant site, endocrine. You see, this cytokine storm means you can imagine what all the problems you can have due to cytokines. So the reason why I mentioned to you these important small things, but it may help you, especially interleukins. So remember the first chart which I had put you earlier, same thing. It's the cytokines which act on the anterior hypothalamus. Prostaglandin is E2 mainly, and ultimately you get a febrile response, and that is what you get in the fever. So I already mentioned to you, early postoperative period, go slow. Don't unnecessarily waste your money evaluating the postoperative fever. Don't ask for again ultrasound, again culture, etc. Reason can be many. I have already mentioned to you about surgical trauma. Patient might have received opioids by the anesthetist or benzodiazepines. Patient may be an alcoholic, and a withdrawal of the alcohol often causes fever. There are so many reasons mentioned for the alcohol withdrawal causing fever. Surgical stress, fear, depression, tissue trauma, and interleukin 6. I am going through the few articles that Whipple's post-operative, Whipple surgery. Interleukin 6 is blamed to cause a post-operative fever for a little longer period. Naturally, we'll be worried, is there a leak from the pancreas, etc. But just to keep you an idea, don't waste your money in the initial post-operative period. As you go to, let us say, second day, etc., basal atelectasis is common. No doubt, very often we take a chest X-ray, but a lot of articles also say that, you know, atelectasis per se may not cause fever. There can be something else. All right, but let us treat it. Hematoma, you would have done the surgery. A classical example is a hydrocele. And today you have done the surgery. Tomorrow patient has got fever and severe pain. It can be a hematoma. It need not have infection, but a large clot there. This I'll be talking a little later about adrenal insufficiency, thyrotoxicosis, etc. Pulmonary embolism can start as early as even on table to even on the second day. So look at here, low grade, short-lived, and gradually disappears within a week. You are totally unaware. Patient might not have had a major manifestation. Of course, if the major manifestation is that patient have got other problems, you would have done. Otherwise, generally, small emboli can cause all these problems, and it may disappear also within a week. Adrenal crisis. It's a basically variable, you know, it can be classified as acute and chronic. It can be due to infections, tuberculosis, fungemia, so many causes. Patient might have had a chronic disease and you would have done surgery. Is an acute crisis would have taken place. So this is some of the time you may respond to even a steroids here, important here. So it needs a replacement therapy. Sepsis is one of the important causes for an adrenal crisis or a surgical stress. So thyrotoxicosis, all of you know, well controlled, you don't get this. But if you don't control the thyrotoxicosis, what we call a thyrotoxicosis storm is one of the, can happen on the table itself. That's why it's first 48 hours. Hypothermia, that's one of the differential diagnosis, malignant hyperthermia. So you may have to treat the patient on beta blockers, intravenous, in fact, propranolol, etc., etc. So just to, this is for your theory purposes, I have given you to write in your paper. Some pictures of basal atelectasis here. You can see a raisiness. Minor sympathetic effusion also is there, all our patients. So early postoperative period, word of caution. As I mentioned to you, don't waste your money, too much money in doing too many investigation. But always remember, especially legs, you can have this myonecrosis, necrotizing fasciitis, and don't underestimate even a bowel leak. especially if it is related to technical issues, even can manifest on the second day. If it is, of course, the vascularity, it will manifest little later. So it's important that if you are having these problems, it need to diagnose immediately. So because this is for you to start the antibiotics empirically. Surgeon might have had a doubt on table itself, but he thought we'll wait and see. Patient might have gone for a hypotension. Patient might have deteriorated in the immediate post-operative period. He has a doubt that it could be a leak. Then you need to evaluate and of course start the whatever antibiotic. Of course, it requires a lot of surgical wisdom in addition to careful examination of the pulse rate or abdominal signs or chest symptoms, etc. So why it can happen? Especially this, what we call as a, these are some kind of a dangerous things can happen. So your patient may be an immunocompromised patient. Okay, obesity also has been blamed for immunocompromised status. Patient may be taking a lot of NSAIDs, maybe for different reason. Deep intramuscular injection you are given, that will can give rise to severe necrotizing fasciitis and the what we call as a myonecrosis, deep injections. Or you would have treated for a colorectal surgery. Organisms from colorectal causes genitourinary can give rise to Fournier's gangrene. So early post-operative pain in the scrotum, very many times you blame it to something else. You may blame to catheter. You're not examining the patient properly. He is slowly developing redness of the scrotum and it can be a Fournier's gangrene. So always look for a risk factor. So first 48 hours, I mentioned to you, surgical stress itself, simple incision. And what are the things you have to care? Alcohol withdrawal, opioids, benzodiazepines. Then I mentioned to you, gave a caution there. A few other things like deep intramuscular injections, leg surgeries, and all this myonecrosis, or what you have done, colorectal surgery, and he has developed a scrotal edema, pain, fever. So immunocompromised patient, oh, he can go for this. Now after 48 hours. So this is common, which I mentioned about wind, water, walking, etc., etc. So everyone has, most of major of our abdominal surgery has a catheter. So we open the dressing, please open 48 to 72 hours and see for any pus or a discharge, send it for culture sensitivity. Look for an IV line. And that's what I meant by examination the patient carefully. That's what in all the debates and all we say, we hear today that today examination of the patient is not done properly. Whether it's the postgraduates or the faculty is not spending time with the patient. Straight away say, I have asked for an ultrasound. I have asked for a chest x-ray. I have sent the blood culture. But examine the patient properly. He can have oral cavity, source of infection itself. So all these things have to be kept in mind. Superficial thrombophlebitis, deep vein thrombosis in the after 48 hours. All I mentioned to you, our patients only. It is not with the intention of the talk. I had saved this. Look at the dates there. It is long back 2012. My patient only evaluated after appendicectomy and ultimately find to have this is the his thrombophlebitis. You can see a line there. After diagnosis of thrombophlebitis, 2 days, antibiotic was not subsided and I gently pressed, pus started coming, whole vein had inside pus. So this is thrombophlebitis. So now device means I mentioned about the catheters, prosthesis, anything is possible there. Always, you know, colonization of the infection can take place, but these are some of the common things. But in ICU setups also remember the candidiasis. So don't underestimate this candidiasis also. The beauty of this is whatever bad fever, you remove the catheter, it usually stops. So pyophlebitis, the pus inside, you know, it ultimately may stop, but antibiotics is mandatory. Don't confuse pyophlebitis to pyelephlebitis. Also, we'll come to that pyelephlebitis, infection of the portal vein and radicals. This is the actually vein itself is the containing pus. What is the mechanism? Simple, you are going through the skin, so it can be a simple migration of the organism from the skin. So no wonder we tell you to clean the area properly before you insert any catheter. And obviously the colony of the organisms are to the tip of the catheter. Or it can be direct contaminant by a contact of the hands, contamination of fluid or devices. Or no doubt you have put the catheter inside. Hematogenous spread is also known for catheter contamination. So again, look at that CVP catheter related fever. And moment you remove the catheter, it stopped. This is the pulse rate. And here is the urinary tract infection. All of you know that you have kept the catheter for more than 7 days and you have not cleaned the area properly, whether it's a female or a male, more so in a male, especially cleaning the preputial area, glans area properly. So urinary tract infection, one of the common causes of a high grade fever, even with the chills and rigors. Moment you remove the catheter, of course, if the urosepsis is dangerous, they can go for a septicemia. It normally responds. I mentioned to you about the resection anastomosis. You can see an anxious look. You can see here, very carefully see here. You can see a center line here. This is a patient who had anastomotic leak for a gangrene and started, you can see here, 3 is the post-operative, he started spiking. 4th spiking, 5th spiking. And this is the time he developed actually a initially treated as a basal atelectasis. In fact, he had. And urine also showed some cells, so treated like UTI. But as I mentioned to you, at some stage, every surgeon would have missed an intra-abdominal catastrophe here. And this is a time one day he suddenly went in for a real post-operative sepsis oliguria. One of the early manifestations of a gram-negative sepsis, especially for surgeons, is oliguria. So, and of course, he was resuscitated. And this was the picture. And that is the time he was re-explored. And there was anastomotic leak. So this actually does not belong to the same patient. I just brought to show different patients having a fever can be related to a surgical case which you operated and a re-leak. So we had a temporary exteriorization and suture, and of course the wound infection. All these are anastomotic leaks which can manifest usually 3 to 5 days later. Usually after 6 to 7 days is unlikely to be anastomotic leak. It's not uncommon to get a residual abscess 4th day, 5th day, 7th day, 8th day. You would have done an appendical abscess itself drainage, or you are treated a patient in a tertiary hospital for a perforated duodenal ulcer, some abscess, somebody had drained. So this is a typical picture. You can see here, Pipzo is piperacillin tazobactam combination. Look at the pattern. It never touches the base. See here? So it's a continuous and you probably less than 1 degree fluctuation. So that's what you get in a residual abscess. I have to tell you an interesting story of a hemorrhoidectomy. Everybody, we thought it's easy. This is only once it happened to me in a post-hemorrhoidectomy status of a patient here. He started spiking the fever actually on the 2nd day. Everybody looked into the wound. Is nothing wrong there? Chest X-ray was normal. Urine was normal. Ultrasound was asked. Ultrasound said something suspicious. Actually, physician who saw his also 2nd day, 3rd day, he looked for malarial parasite also. Endemic areas, sometimes it happens here. But ultrasound gave a clue to me for me to go for a CT scan. And that is what is shown. This CT does not belong to this patient. This is a different patient. But this patient CT I do not have. This is actually a pyelophlebitis. This patient had a portal pyemia. Look at this temperature. He had some 28,000 counts. Very toxic, high grade fever. And he ultimately responded. So that is what you should know. That's a portal pyemia, the liver abscesses following a hemorrhoidectomy patient. Respiratory infections, everyone knows. Have you diagnosed a pneumonia? Yes, but we have referred the patient to physician. It's better that you show more interest in this, how you treat the pneumonia, when it presents, what is the culture there, Klebsiella, Streptococci, Haemophilus influenza, late onset, methicillin resistance, MRSA, Pseudomonas, Acinetobacter, all these are possible in today's setup, especially ventilator associated pneumonia. I think I will not deal more about that. Once it goes to there, the pathology and the manifestation are different. As a surgeon, how we should be able to pick up this lesion. Post-esophageal jejunostomy patient, there's no leak actually, but they can definitely go. You would have treated the patient for Ivor Lewis here. So there's a possibility, or it can be ventilator associated pneumonitic patches here and there, a pneumonia patch. So you should be vigilant after 4 to 3 to 5 days later, whether it's a anastomotic leak, as I mentioned to you, that's what did we do, anastomosis, or whether it is a catheter related or a lungs problem here, that's a wind, or it's the water, that's a urine, especially E. coli, gram negative is quite common here. Simple urine examination may give you a clue, or it could be a coagulase negative staph. So these are various causes of a urinary tract infection. Very often it is hospital acquired, but of course patient can be diabetic also. IV fluids is very rare nowadays to get, but it's possible. Not that nothing can be ruled out, just like blood transfusion also can give rise to fever. But IV fluids, there may be a contamination or whatever. You stop that IV and give now something else, it completely stops. Something like this happens means you know it is not related to a real sepsis inside. Intra-abdominal collections, very often you see here. Look at the charts, how it goes. And it's only after drain it comes down. Whether it's a perforated DU or whether it's a pancreatitis patients who have been conservative treatment. And after some time, you know, after 4 weeks, how or third week onwards, how do they respond to the management of US? So all this will reflect, tell you intra-abdominal collections, wherever it is. Yes, we always used to tell, no, pus nowhere, pus somewhere, pus under the diaphragm. It can be very well under the diaphragm. Surgical site infections, all of you know, incision site or an organ space or a superficial here from incision or a deep, including muscles and fascia. So it all depends upon how much is the microbial contamination in the wound. You, all of you know the classification of clean contaminated, of course, dirty and ugly wounds, etc. So simple to give an example, like a lap cholecystectomy, ideally should not give rise to any infection. No doubt there is a, at one stage, you're going to cut the cystic duct, so bile, that's why it's clean contaminated. So duration, more number of hours, more than 3 hours. Host factors, very important here. So all these will cause a chance of a surgical site infection. But basically, what is that underlying disease you are treating, you know? Tuberculosis, enteric fever, so many causes are there. That's an intra-abdominal sepsis, which I had spoken earlier. But what are the common things everybody should know? These are the things for the group A streptococcal cellulitis or a necrotizing fasciitis. Don't confuse the necrotizing fasciate when I say only in the leg. Necrotizing fasciate is the broader term now. In fact, Fournier's gangrene word is not there now. It's basically they're all perineal phlegmons of a necrotizing fasciitis type 1, type 2. Abdominal melony gangrene, they're all grouped under necrotizing fasciitis. Clostridial wound infection, all are known. What do you suspect if you suspect clostridial? Yes, you suspect X-ray or MRI. You may get a surgical emphysema in the abdominal wall, very dangerous. So surgical debridement should be done, early option. And of course, hyperbaric oxygen. If you have facility for a antitoxin, you give it. What about the group A hemolytic streptococcal infection? Again, cellulitis here. Streptococcus produces more of a cellulitis. Staph produces more of an abscess, including parotid abscess, osteomyelitic abscesses, any abscess, breast abscess, I think all of you know. So these are some of the various drugs. Always send a culture and accordingly. Otherwise, you should know what organism and start at least empirical. Depends upon your hospital status. Yeah, this is, of course, the open, this one, lab cholecystectomy patient. It got converted. And, or I think it's open cholecystectomy. Wound infection to show the clips there. So I have mentioned about already necrotizing fasciitis. What to be done for that? Clindamycin is the choice of antibiotic. But remember, extensive debridement is required. Whether it's the abdominal wall, whether it is the leg, or whether the deep intramuscular gluteal injection that has caused a necrosis there, etc. All, so that is what is required. That's one of the causes, one of the patients who came actually after surgery for a diabetic ulcer who had extensive fasciotomies, multiple fasciotomy for a compartment, came with a ketoacidosis, and it was almost like a myonecrosis. So this is what we have done for this patient. Now look at this patient who has undergone a resection anastomosis. In fact, this patient came with a gangrene. There is no anastomotic leak in this patient. Interestingly, there's no anastomotic leak, but it was a incision site infection, subcutaneous. Look at the here charts. Again, at this stage, we have opened the wound and look for any redness, erythema, no. I was tempted to open the sutures there. Then, of course, always there's a discussion. Then it was opened somewhere here. Look at that, how temperature has come down. Look at that creamy pus, you can see here. So this is some of the list here, right? So anaerobic streptococci, staph. So there are various organisms can produce this kind of a delayed wound infection. When I say delayed here, more than 96 hours. So surgical, whenever you have operated on a patient who has got a, let us say, gangrene of the bowel, you thought there is significant contamination. There are two ways of looking at the problem. Actually, you don't have to close all these skin sutures, but keep them, don't tighten them. After 2 or 3 days later, you can tighten here, right? So this is how with the surgical site infections can happen. Yeah, iatrogenic is something which everyone should know. So this is a situation where a iatrogenic injury of the ileum has happened in a patient who has undergone actually a cesarean section. You have another patient here, you can't call it, it's a re-leak actually in an ileal perforation. So these are the things which can happen, especially enteric perforation closure. So this is how you should know that re-leaks are known. Re-leaks are known. Sound good. You can see here frank peritonitis due to ileal perforation, and here you can see the enteric perforation. So most common infections occurring after surgery, I think I have already told you now. These are wound infections, urinary infections, postoperative pneumonia, catheters, intra-abdominal infection, and prosthesis. So you can see here, a patient who had a perforated DU came with a subphrenic abscess here. You can see the temperature and a pigtail insertion done, and temperature comes down. Interestingly, a patient with the vaginal hysterectomy came with the sepsis, high-grade fever, and when we did the CT, you can see here, this is actually gauze pieces. Somebody wanted to control it from below, vaginal hysterectomy. They bleeding. They went on putting these roller gauze pieces, which went up in the peritoneal cavity. And this is how it happened, called a gossipy bioma. Of course, that's the leukocytosis. So I have given you the most important causes list and you know how to suspect which day, 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, etc. And now we'll come to the uncommon causes. They are non-infectious. One is the peritonitis. You know, this post-operative period, already dehydrated patient, debilitated patient, malnourished, poor oral hygiene, diabetic, elderly. So these secretions coming from the parotid get inspissated and you get a peritonitis can produce fever. That is why I mentioned to you that complete examination of the patient. You don't know, most of our patients fall under this, elderly patients, peritonitis patients. So it's just do a simple examination. I didn't want to use the word head to toe, but it's better that, remember like that, you can see the parotid enlargement there. And of course, culture is important here. If a staph may be responsible, you can try cloxacillin If it doesn't respond, you may have to try vancomycin. Treatment of peritonitis is a different issue that you have to treat. I mentioned to you sometime back, basal atelectasis need not have infection, right? These are the patients. Often you have an elderly smoker, upper abdominal surgery, they can't breathe because of that stenting effect of the diaphragm. So basal atelectasis is there, just wait. A good incentive spirometry, good breathing exercises, he will improve. If it doesn't improve, of course, you should not go for a pneumonia, etc. So these are some of the reasons have been mentioned for this. So up to 48, even 72 hours, you can call it like that. Beyond which, think it's a pneumonia, right? Deep vein thrombosis, you can see here, almost mimicking like a necrotizing fasciitis postoperatively. Yes, if this is the picture of a postoperative patient, easy, but very often you don't find. And you don't examine the patient. If you ask the patient, she will tell, I got an unusual type of a pain in my cough, a bursting type of a pain. And of course, lady, obesity, pills, all this, you know, causes in our patient, given patient. So do play, you do immediately. And of course, low molecular. And that is how you treat this patient. Transfusion reactions, they are minor and major. I'll not talk more about that, but remember, you have transfused the blood. Yes, it's possible. Keep it in mind. You have to consider them because it can also give rise to a bronchospasm, etc. And these are the various other things what can happen, including hepatitis, HIV, cytomegaly virus. So best way to avoid is a leukocyte poor red cell, washed red cell transfusion. That is the best, rather than taking a major blood. One or two slides about this malignant hyperthermia. I already mentioned to you, earlier halothane was used very regularly, but it's not used, but other drugs of anesthetics are used, including isoflurane, sevoflurane, etc. Rarely it can happen, not very common, but remember it's an inherited autosomal. So if there is a history, yes, otherwise it's difficult to diagnose, but you should be always ready. Dantrolene sodium is the drug of choice for this. They can produce an extensive release of calcium from the skeletal muscle because of this halogenated inhalation anesthetics. And this is what you get, a hyperthermia, increased body temperature, etc. A differential diagnosis for malignant hyperthermia is including a thyrotoxic storm, which I already mentioned to you. You use the word there, thyrotoxic storm, where there's hyperpyrexia, severe dehydration, so volume replacement, IV propranolol, tepid sponging, all that has to be done. This is also called as neuroleptic malignant syndrome. What is this? This is basically used the term for antipsychotic medications. There are many patients, almost every antipsychotic drug can give rise to this, but few of them can trigger this. There are flufenazine and haloperidol. So one should be aware of this. These are for postgraduates who write the theory paper of, say, postoperative fever. Then these are the things which will help them. But in the real practice, probably may not come across. I have not come across this, neither this anesthetic drug induced, including thyrotoxic storm. I have not seen. So now evaluation of the postoperative. So I've given you all the causes. So it may be possible that one or two I would have missed. But septic focus basically should be looked for, starting from the head to toe, as I mentioned to you. So post-appendicectomy fever, Perry-and-Law gives top 1 to 10. What are things you examine? Starting from parotid, everything you look, including the deep vein thrombosis, local ear, wound, etc. But the 6 or 7 W's, which I mentioned, remember. Yes. How to evaluate? I mentioned you first day. No, don't do anything. It's a cytokine release. Next, after 48 hours only, think about cultures. Simple is the total count, gives you some idea, but immunocompromised status, diabetic patients, you may not get a high total count, but so don't rely only on the total count. Yes, cultures, Gram stain, this I think everyone knows, one who has worked in the ward, that's what a post-operative ward round means, this is what you do. Have you taken a chest x-ray? A patient is coughing out sputum, and of course, a reactivation of tuberculosis, or all this history you have to take. I suppose you know that what are things you need to do. Patient was on ventilator, tracheal aspirates. These are the things which you need to do. Patient has said, ultrasound said some fluid collection, pancreatic collection, or whatever cholecystitis. You are treating a conservative management. You're not operated here maybe, but patient has got, so you always tap the secretion. That's what I want to convey. Tap the collection. Appropriate imaging. Yes, when it is required, CT scan has to be done. Otherwise, ultrasound can definitely pick up a solid or a fluid collections. So only when in doubt. This problem is, I have not seen too many, but Indian scenario, especially this is an antibiotic induced diarrhea. So, but here, I think list I have given you, fluoroquinolines, cephalosporins, and clindamycin also give rise to diarrhea. And irony is that you need to give some drugs to treat the diarrhea of this, including vancomycin for this. So it can give rise to toxic megacolon. And these are patients who can get discharged from the hospital and come back after 3 weeks as a diarrhea. That's why I mentioned to you, post-operative period fever means 1 month. All these are necessary investigation. Do it as and when required. So what about this? Are the antibiotics indicated at all? Not necessary in every patient. Should I start immediately intra-abdominal collection and pneumonia? Definitely yes. Every hospital will have some kind of antibiotic policy. Intra-abdominal collection due to a bowel viscous definitely may require 2 or 3 drugs, cephalosporins, including anaerobes. Which organism is likely? Yes, gram negative. I have already given you the list. If there's a wound infection, early post-operative period, third day, staph, or even anaerobic streptococci, etc. Or is a deep-seated infection, maybe a gram negative one. Single antibiotic, yes, clindamycin sometimes, well and good sometimes, for depends upon your case. Or patient has got pyelophlebitis. I showed you that multiple liver abscesses and portal pyemia. It may not respond to ordinary. So I mentioned to you about piperacillin and tazobactam combination with or without even a metronidazole required. 3 drugs, ampigenta metro combination or the old one. Today you can give cephalosporins. Even a gram negative cover is excellent for a E. coli, but you need to monitor the urinary output and renal status. Whenever you need to send some cultures, don't be in a hurry, maybe 5 days, 10 days, like that. These are all happens in a patient who stays for a longer period of time in the post-operative ward. But he has got temperature, how do you control? This is simple paracetamol, aspirin, NSAIDs. Steroids are required, definitely in adrenal insufficiency, even in a, whenever, because basically they are anti-inflammatory, right? So that is what I mentioned, in when, especially even in a malignant hyperthermia, may not respond to antipyretics, you may have to give us steroids. So there is a definite role for a steroid, but one has to do it carefully. So this is what is the thing which I wanted to convey, that we have done a conclusions. Now we'll come to that. So post-operative fever is not uncommon. Range up to, sometime 3 to 30%, some article 10 to 25%. Initial 1 or 2 days, wait, don't go. Surgery itself is a stress. Slowly, slowly think of all those W's which I mentioned to you. But always remember, common sense should be there always. Examine the patient, talk to the patient. He will give a clue. My leg is aching. I got some breathing difficulty. I got pain in the right hypochondrium. This patient of hemorrhoidectomy, he complained. Somehow, not blaming anyone for that matter. We have missed it. We missed it. Detected only after 4 days or 5 days later with that high swinging temperature. Common pathogens, every hospital should have an idea. Fever is more likely to infection as the time following surgery increases. What I'm trying to tell is, surgery done today, after 5 days he has got fever, most likely it is the surgical cause. That means there is a definite source of infection, either abdomen or maybe pneumonia or whatever it is. Appropriate antibiotics to be given at the right time. And of course, intervention should be rightly done. As I mentioned to you, several temperature charts where you drain the pus, it will stop. But what is important here is, initially I put those 6 or 7 slides. Fever as a manifestation of sepsis should be promptly diagnosed. I mentioned to you about the Q and Q SOFA scoring. I hope if postgraduates can take that message and the common causes, and if you know how to put the score, that is wonderful. And of course, immunocompromised status, I mentioned to you, infection, non-infectious causes, individualized approach. At the end, I mentioned to you about the common sense and common wisdom and all that thing. Experience is the hard teacher because she gives the test first and lesson afterwards. If you have any problem, ask your senior colleague. He will tell, see, I have seen a case like this. It responds like this. It very often works. So with this, these are my various references. And I conclude. And thank you. And if you have any feedback, you can send. Or if you have any doubts, or if time permits, Dr. Radhakrishna, I can take a few questions. So thank you very much for patient hearing.
I mean, there can't be a better lecture on fever than this, sir. I never imagined, sir. It's so creative, so informative. And I'm sure you worked hard on this. And especially seeing all those the fever charts from yesteryears, I think, you know, that's how I think teachers should evolve.
Wonderful. No, sir. Yeah, everybody should follow that, because I think every surgeon would have seen the temperature chart. Every surgeon, not only me or somebody, but what happens is, it gives you some idea when you put, for example, this type of a slides. So it gives an exact picture, you know, when the temperature has come down and why it has come down. So that should be the way in which we learn also. So I thought, you know, to preserve this kind of a things much earlier.
Actually, these fever things which we see every day in our clinical practice, every single day. And then, you know, we hardly have this idea that we should photograph and keep them.
As we start referring the so many papers, you find so many articles, one comparing only post-operative day one fever, right. Day one, like day two, like that.
So there's a question in the chat box. Naren is just curious. He says, why did you go for a CT in that hemorrhoidectomy patient?
Why did you go, or why did not go?
Why did you go for a CT?
Probably that time it was a post-hemorrhoidectomy status and all. I mentioned to you, ultrasound showed a hepatomegaly, and that patient, we have done a CT scan, but I was not able to get that CT picture. That's what I said. We have done. I think we should do, because I know it's a post-hemorrhoidectomy status, but you don't know sometimes a complicated of hemorrhoids, especially nowadays. There are articles on a simple banding of a hemorrhoid giving rise to pyelophlebitis. So CT will give a better picture of liver as well as intra-abdominal. I thought whether anything else has happened.
I think these days everybody goes for CT at a very less threshold, because we have seen whenever we have our ID people treating our patients, and one of the things is to find out a source. And then of course we have the great concept of source control.
Of course, that is ultimate.
If you see a source, please do something about it. You know, even the ICU people said just operate and try to get rid of it, which we don't do often, because many a times that sort of an aggressive treatment may not be necessary. Any comments or questions?
Dr. Nooli, sir. Nooli, sir.
No, sir. It was excellent, sir. It was excellent. Only few suggestions I wanted to make, sir.
Sir,
in the post-operative period, when the work is over, like, for example, now intravenous cannula should be removed as soon as the antibiotics have stopped or anything. And once the patient starts moving, you remove the catheter also. Yes. Don't keep any invasive things.
I think some net problem.
That was one comment I wanted to make, sir.
Correct. That's what including CVP, etc., etc., they have to serve the purpose for why these have been put. That's what is very clear. Our patients are, when you do a major abdominal surgery, complicated surgery, tertiary referral patients, these complications get multiplied. But message is very clear to everyone that whatever indwelling catheters, all that has to be removed as soon as possible when that purpose for which it has been put.
Yes, sir.
Correct.
Yes,
good sir. Message.
Sir, Bhavik is asking when one should consider to add antifungal in treatment, surgeon's perspective.
As I mentioned, only in ICU setups. Mm-hmm. ICU setups, it is never to be used in a lighter way. Chemotherapy patient who has received radiotherapy, cancer patients. So when they are in ICU setup, when they are not responding to the conventional thing, antibiotics have been given long period, they tend to grow the fungal cultures there. So we also, it happens in our ICU setups also. So fungemia, that's what catheter related complications and a respiratory system. Yes.
Sir, how often do you use this anti-heparin and all those things, sir? Any indications you make routinely?
To prevent the deep vein thrombosis, and nowadays we are using routinely, sir, low molecular weight heparin. In all the patients who undergo especially laparotomy, we'll put that scoring system is there. But generally we do it. But thyroidectomy also, they have mentioned if it takes long time, but we don't use it for that purpose.
Okay. Sir, Shanay sir, I think you should come up with a lecture on this PVT prophylaxis.
Maybe I will do it some other time. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
And metoclopramide is one more, sir. We had one worst experience with metoclopramide injection, sir. Routinely used by these anesthesists. That also sometimes produces fever, sir. Metoclopramide. Uh-huh. Anti-emetic.
Yes.
So Dr. Srihar Rao, Professor of Surgery, says excellent slides, excellent talk.
He's from Tirupati, no?
Tirupati, yes, sir.
I know.
A good friend also. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, our friend also.
So thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful lecture.
Thank you, sir.
You made such an interesting thing of out of fever. And anyway, this lecture will be in the archives of Learning General Surgery for people to get back to and see again and again and learn things better. Have a nice evening, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Noli, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.